Good afternoon, everyone. Thanks for coming. Today, I'm going to talk about on merger of axon-dermatic clamps and perimetric resonance of photons. This presentation is based on several of my papers, but I will mainly focus on the last one. In this paper, I explored the presence of axon-dermatic clamps today in the galactic halo and how this clamp can merge and produce an astrophysical signature that we can detect on the Earth. So this is the outline of my presentation. Let's start. As you know, a wide range of astrophysical observations such as CMB and galactic rotation curves are very well explained by including cold dark matter. A popular dark matter candidate is the QCD axion, and the QCD axion corresponds to a pseudo-Gaussian boson associated with the spontaneous UV breaking of the U1PQ symmetry, and the symmetry was introduced in order to solve the strong CP problem. At the classical level, the axion field is massless, but the axion field acquired a mass after the QCD phase transition via the QCD potential, due to non-perturbative effects of the QCD, and then the axion field starts to oscillate and act as a form of cold dark matter. In recent years, there have been an extensive searches for the axion, including but not limited to anoscopes, telescopes, axon-induced atomic and molecular transitions, and indirect axon searches. The important thing here is many of these searches are based on this dimension phi operator. This operator represents the axion photocoupling, in which the G phi gamma gamma correspond to the axion photocoupling, phi is the axion field, and EV the electromagnetic field. So now I will explain what is the novel scenario that I will address in this presentation. So in the early universe, a portion of axion we organize in order to form this axion dermatic clamp, this two bosons and condensate. So as you know, for a moderate value of the axion photocoupling constant, there is a critical mass for an axion clamp at which the axion clamp may undergo parametric resonance of photons. So today in the galaxy, in the galactic halo, we find a kind of pileup of the axon dermatic clamps, which are subcritical. I mean, all the masses for the axon dermatic clamps are pretty similar, and these masses are less than the critical value. So in order to have clamps above the critical mass, in the galaxy today, we require mergers. So in this presentation, we will study the parameter space in order to have this merger after the collision between axon dermatic clamps in the galactic halo, and how the output of coherent radio waves may potentially be detected on the Earth. So, but what is an axon dermatic clamp? An axon dermatic clamp is an astrophysical object which is the result of the balance of three forces: gravity, attractive QCD cell interaction, and the kinetic pressure. So in the non-relativistic regime, we have two kinds of configuration. One configuration are stable and the other configuration are unstable. So we will mainly focus on the stable configuration. These axon dermatic clamps in the literature are also named as axon stars or Bose stars. So in the typical scenario for formation of axon dermatic clamps, we have the picture at which the PQ symmetry is broken after inflation. In this case, the axon field remains inhomogeneous from one Hubble patch to the next, as suggested by causality. Then, a strong Monod gravitational interaction may lead to the Bose-Santa condensate formation. So, in order to avoid the domain wall problem, we can just set the domain wall number equal to 1, and then we can have axon dermatic clamps with an axon decay constant ranging between 10 to the 9 GeV and 10 to the 11 GeV. So I am thinking I am thinking that the QCD axon is the dark matter in the universe. However, we have another scenario, and this is a scenario correspond to the picture at which the PQ symmetry is broken before inflation. So, as you know, in this picture, the axion field is running to be highly homogeneous on large scales. Then it is not clear if in the late universe the axion field may organize and go to the formation of these bosons and condensate. However, Matt Hertzberg, Tsutomu Yanagida, and the speaker this year show that axon and matter class may kinetically nucleate in darkening halo around primordial black holes in the scenario at which the PQ symmetry is broken before inflation. As you know, after the gravitational wave detection, the LIGO-Virgo collaboration, primordial black holes, the idea of primordial black holes have been strongly revitalized. Then, if primordial black holes exist, then we need to take seriously the possibility that axons and matter clumps nucleate in mini halos around primordial black holes before the time of first galaxy formation. Also, Fukunaga this year showed that axon-like particles clumps may form via tachyonic instability in the scenario at which the PQ symmetry is broken before inflation. So in this scenario, the axion decay constant can take a very wide range from 10 to the 9 GeV and 10 to the 17 GeV if you consider the axionic anthropic window. So in the effective theory of axion, we can express the Lagrangian density for the axion mechanical wave, in which V corresponds to the QCD potential coming from non-perturbative QCD effects. So we can expand this potential around the CPU perceived vacuum in order to obtain this expression, in which lambda, the quartic coupling, is expressed in terms of the axon mass and the axon decay constant and the parameter gamma. The value of gamma is the other one, and it depends on the exact form of the potential. For the case of the Dirichlet gas instanton approximation, gamma is equal to one, but for the case at which the QCD potential is more accurate, as was shown by Greeley et al. In 2016, gamma is around 0.3. So this corresponds to the relation between the axion mass and the axial decay constant for the case of the QCD axion. So due to we are mainly interested in the non-relativistic regime, it's very useful to re-express the real axon field in terms of a complex Schrödinger field, which is a slowly varying in this way. So M corresponds to the mass of the axon field and give you the main frequency, the fundamental frequency of the field. And we can study the dynamic of the Schrödinger field just obtaining the non-relativistic Hamiltonian. And this non-relativistic Hamiltonian can be split in this way, in a kinetic part, in an interacting part, and in a gravitating. So you realize that the non-relativistic Hamiltonian carries a global Newman symmetry associated with a concerned number of particles. And this is expected because in the non-relativistic regime, changing number processes are highly suppressed. So from the Hamiltonian equation, we can obtain the equation of motion of the field. So here we obtain the Schrödinger Newton equation plus the Newton-Poisson equation and the tilde represent dimensionless quantity. So here is the relation between the dimensionless quantities and the dimensional full quantities. So the relation depends on the Planck mass, the gamma parameter, the axion mass, and the axion decay constant. So we are interested in two Bose-Einstein condensates. This corresponds to the ground state configuration. We can express the Schrödinger field in this way as a stationary solution. And due to we are talking about ground state configuration, the solution needs to be spherically symmetric. So the time independent field equation for a spherical symmetric Einstein state is given by this expression, and there is no analytical solution. So, but we can always solve this equation numerically, and also we can propose an answer. Here we find the numerical solution for the axion field for some specific number of particles in this blue line, and the green line and the orange line correspond to the two different answers. You can see that the Sesh answer is very close to the numerical solution. So the Sesh answer is able to capture most of the physics of the problem. So the Sesh answer is given for this expression. So this answer depends only on one parameter, which corresponds to the length scale. So the length scale will lead to different shape of the axion field. So in general, any localized answer which depends on only one single parameter, R, will lead to this expression for the non-relativistic Hamiltonian. A, B, C are just coefficients, and the idea is we can extremize this non-relativistic Hamiltonian with respect to the variation of parameter, and we can apply the variation of principle in order to obtain the parameter space for solutions. If we do that, we obtain this relation between the number of particles and the length scale. So this is the parameter space for solution. We obtain two branches of solutions. The blue branch corresponds to a stable solution, and the red line corresponds to the unstable branch. So for a fixed number of particles, we have two solutions. The stable solution corresponds to a local minimum in the Hamiltonian, but the unstable solution corresponds to this maxima in the Hamiltonian. Other thing which is very interesting is that there is a maximum number of particles that we can put in a clamp. If these clamps aggregate more particles from the background, then it will undergo instability under the radiation of relativistic axions. So there's a maximum number of particles which can be in a clamp, and this maximum number of particles is associated with a minimum rise. So this is the physical parameter for axion clamps. This is the maximum mass, which is the order of 10 to the minus 11 solar masses. And this is the minimum radius associated with the maximum mass, which is pretty small, is the order of 80 kilometers. You can realize that you can express any mass for axion clamps in terms of this maximum mass just using this parameterization. Alpha goes from 0 to 1. When alpha approaches to 0, we are moving in this direction in this stable branch. So you can express any mass for any axion clamps and the associated radio just using this maximum mass and using some just a factor alpha, and alpha go to 0 and 1. So when alpha is 1, just the mass is equal to the maximum mass. Now, so we want to study action and photons, and axions coupled to photon via a fermion loop. This corresponds to the Lagrangian of interaction, and For conventional action models, the action photocopying constant is the order of 10 to minus 2 over the action decay constant. So you can vary this Lagrangian in terms of the with respect to the quantized vector potential for vector potential, and then you take this equation, and then you go to the Fourier space and obtain this equation. So, for example, if you have an homogeneous condensate in the early universe, you see just the K-mode decouple. But if you consider localized action clamps, this equation is quite complicated. So I will just show you what is the result of the parametric resonance, and I will not go to the detail. So when you analyze the parametric resonance of axiodramatic clamps, what happened is there is an exponential growth for the photon occupancy number when the resonance is shut on, is clicked on. So, but when you have a localized axiodramatic clamps, not always there is a resonance. You need to require some condition. And the condition corresponds to that the growth rate for the homogeneous case needs to be greater than the scale photon rate. The scale photon rate is just 1/2 times the radius of the clamp. So you can transform this condition in a condition for the axial photocopying constant. So you see that the axial photocopying constant times the axial decay constant needs to be greater than 0.28. So this value, the minimum value is equal is 1 when you have the maximum number of particles in a clamp. So you obtain a minimum value for the axial photocoupling constant in order to have parametric resonance. So we are obtaining value for the order 10 to minus 2 over FA. So QCD axion will not undergo parametric resonance, but you can expect parametric resonance, for example, for coupling to hidden sector photons or axion-like particles or unconventional axion models.
Sorry, may I ask you?
Yes.
So you need large coupling to photons in order to have parametric resonance?
Yes.
And what is the threshold value? Is this
this is the value. It's the order of 10 to minus 1.
Okay. And the KSVG would be smaller than this?
For the QCD, KCVC model, for example, or DFSCC model is this. So it's just 10 order less.
Okay. Okay. Let's see. Thanks.
Okay. Okay, so now I will study action star merger because we are in the scenario in which all the clamps in the galactic halo has subcritical mass. So I will want to extend supercritical mass in order this clamp can go to parametric resonance. So we carry out a full three-dimensional simulation using rectangular coordinates. And we work in a periodic boundary condition, and we put a sponge in the boundary in order to absorb all the scalar waves which are scattered off from the merger process. So we use just the Schrödinger equation in order to evolve the initial wave function. The initial wave function corresponds to two clamps, and each of these clamps satisfies the Schrödinger equation. So now, the important thing here is the initial total energy of the synthesis of the system needs to be positive. Sorry, needs to be negative in order to have merger. If the initial total energy of the system is positive, you have an unbounding system. Then the collision will not lead to a merger. So you can see that in this snapshot from the local number density, these two clamps collide but pass through each other, and then there is no final merger. However, you can have the condition at which the initial total energy is negative. In this case, you have merger. Here, you have the evolution of the number of particles, the total number of particles with respect of time. So here is when the coalescent process happened, and there is a violent relaxation. So there is a great ejection of particles from the center, and these particles are absorbed. from the sponge. So the rate here of the ejected particle, dn over dt, is the order of 10 to minus 1 or 10 to minus 2. It's very high. Then the ejection of particle, the rate, it becomes slower, and then asymptotically approach it to 10 to minus 7 and 10 to minus 8. We stop the simulation at that time, around 8 sunset, in code unit of time. So at that time, the clamps seems to settle down in the grounds in configuration, because we want to have grounds in configuration in order to have parametric resonance. So this is the evolution of the energy and their components. So the red line corresponds to the total energy. You see that it's negative at the beginning, and then the energy decreases because there is particles which are ejected from the center of the cosmological box when the coalescent process is happening. So finally, we want to check if the resultant clamps correspond to a ground state configuration or at least very close to one. So here, the dot points correspond to the simulation. They correspond to the values of the field of the simulation. And the blue line correspond to the theoretical prediction. If you solve the Newton-Schrödinger equation using the same value for the amplitude at the center that the simulation tells you. If you do that, you will realize that the agreement is remarkable. So that strongly suggests that we have a ground state configuration or very close to one, because if you here we are plotting what is the evolution of time of one point in the field. This is the origin. So you see that the imaginary part and the real part of the field just oscillate, but the absolute value undergoes tiny, tiny oscillation. So you can think about that. You have a ground state configuration which undergo a radial perturbation. So eventually, when the time runs, the system will settle down to the ground state. Now, we want to study what is the parameter space for merger. So,
can I ask a question?
Yes, of course.
I had a question. On the previous slide, what is the time scale in units of the mass of the axion?
This one.
Sorry.
No, it's okay.
So
it's the order of years, but it can be the order of hours, for example, if you consider large value for axion decay constant.
But is this in terms of if I was,
this is the real time.
If I'm just looking at the, instead of the real time, I'm just looking in terms of the T tilde. Is that just M inverse? Is the units of T tilde just M inverse? I forget.
Oh, no, T tilde depends on fundamental variable. So here, let me see here. Yeah. Depends on the axion decay constant and the axion mass.
Oh,
this is the transformation. This is the dimension and this is okay. Right. So. Okay, now, so we want to analyze what is the parameter space for merger, because we need to require a negative initial total energy. So if the initial separation of clamps is large enough, then you can estimate the total initial energy just summing the individual energy for each clamp plus the kinetic energy of the center of mass of each clamp plus the gravitational attraction between clamps. If you do that, you can apply the Sesh-Ansel's approximation and obtain an expression for the Hamiltonian. If you do that, you obtain these two plots. In the first plot, I am showing you how the initial energy of the system, the total energy, change with the velocity of each clamp. As the velocity increases, of course, the initial energy increases. But the important thing here is there is a critical velocity at which the total energy of the system is zero. So all the velocity less than the critical will lead to a merger. So using this relation, the relation between the critical velocity and the relative critical velocity and the axial decay constant, you can obtain this counterplot. Here, the parameter space is the number of particles of the clamps and the axial decay constant, and we are showing what is the real relative critical velocity, so of the clamps. As you know, you expect that the axon clamps will have 10 to the 2 kilometers per second in the galactic halo as the relative velocity. So, for example, this line corresponds to 100 kilometers per second, this line 200 kilometers per second. So you expect that that you will have merger after collision if the decay constant is quite large, at least is greater than 10 to the 15 GeV. However, you can still have merger if the axial decay constant is less than 10 to the 15 GeV, because the relative velocity of the axon-domatic clamps in the galactic halo is not fixed. Indeed, it corresponds a distribution, a Gaussian distribution. So you eventually can found the right relative velocity in order to produce merger. Now we want to analyze what are the astrophysical signatures that are related to this scenario. First, I will calculate the collision rate and then the merger rate. For the collision rate, this is a standard. Here, this corresponds to the distribution of the dark matter in the galactic halo. This is the fraction in dark matter in axon-domatic clamps. This corresponds to the effective cross-section, which is the geometrical cross-section enhanced by the gravitational focusing. And this is the average of the effective cross-section times the relative velocity. We consider the relative velocity of the axon clamp, the order of the velocity of the axon clamps, and we calculate this term using this integral. This corresponds to a Gaussian velocity probability distribution. And here, the two parameters which is important correspond to the circular velocity at the solar position and the escape velocity from the galaxy at the solar position. So, in order to get a taste about the collision rate, you can suppose that the distribution of dark matter is just homogeneous. And then we calculate the collision rate. And here the important thing is when the axial decay constant is greater than 10 to the 15 GeV, the geometrical focusing is the order of the gravitational focusing is the order of the geometrical cross section. Now, so here I am showing you the collision rate versus the axial decay constant. So the homogeneous case corresponds to the blue line, and these three overlap cases correspond when you consider some specific dark matter distribution in the galactic halo, such as NFW profile or Burkitt profile. You see that for the homogeneous case subestimate the collision rate for order of 10 to the 2. But the important thing here is the collision rate can vary a lot depending on the axial decay constant. And here I am just choosing one dark matter distribution mass model, and I am varying the fraction in dark matter and the number of particles in the clamp. So the larger the fraction in the fraction of dark matter in clamps, and the smaller the clamps, so the collision rate is greater. Because in this case, you have more clamps, and these clamps are larger, so the collision rate is larger. However, we are interested not in the collision rate, we are interested in the merger rate. So,
about 5 minutes. Just a reminder, about 5 minutes.
Oh, yeah. We are interested in the merger rate. So, the merger rate, so we can obtain the merger rate just replacing the escape velocity from the galaxy for the critical relative velocity. So in this case, we are sure that one collision will lead to a merger. And if this is the case, we obtain this merger rate, and regrettably is quite small. So the order is 10 to minus 8, 10 to minus 10. So it will be interesting to analyze a specific scenario in order to enhance the merger rate. For example, considering three-body interaction. Here we are only working in two-body interactions. So now the photon, the idea is you have this subcritical mass because there is a pile up at a unique value in the galactic halo today. Because suppose that the axion photocoupling constant is greater than a minimal value. So this axion photocoupling constant is associated with a critical number of particles. Suppose this is the critical number of particles. This is the distribution of clumps in the early universe. So all clumps which has a supercritical mass, they go to resonance and they go to the critical number of particles. And all clumps which are subcritical will aggregate dark matter from the background, and then we go to the critical number of particles. Then you expect like a kind of pile up of number of particles in the galactic halo. So in order to obtain supercritical mass, you need merger. And the rule of the merger is the following. So the final mass or the final number of particles is the order of 0.7, the sum of the progenitor masses. So the 30% of the original mass is scattered off in the way of scalar waves. So we can calculate the energy of emission of the clumps, and also we can calculate what is the time scale for the exponential growth in the photon opacity number. Just calculating the inverse of the growth rate is quite small, in the order of milliseconds. And then you can calculate what is the frequency. And here, if we want to study the detectability, we need to study what is the frequency of emission. In the case when the axion decay constant is small, the frequency of emission just is in the window from the current radio telescope and also from the prospective radio telescope. Regrettable, when the axion decay constant is larger than 10 to the 15 GeV, the frequency is less than 30 megahertz, and it's quite difficult to detect this photon on the Earth. So in order to do that, you need radio telescope from space. But there are some future plan in order to do that. So, and finally, we want to calculate what is the spectral flux density, per, in the case when you have these axonomatic clumps and undergoes to parametric resonance, this value is quite large, because if you compare this value with the smaller the spectral flux density that the radio telescope need in order to detect the photon emission. For example, in the case of SKA, it's a specific radio telescope, the minimum spectral flux density is much more smaller than the spectral flux density that will be produced by this parametric resonance. So in conclusion, the big problem here is that the merger rate is quite low, and we need to study a specific, more particular scenario in order to see if there's some possibility of enhance this merger rate. And with this last thought, I am ending my presentation. Thank you for listening to me.
Right, thank you very much, Rico, for this presentation. And it's time for any questions.
Hello. Question, Enrico, what about thinking in some generic scalar dark matter, but with repulsive interaction. What is your feeling about that?
I see. So, right. As you know, the QCD axion has a quartic attracted cell interaction. So you can think about in a generic scalar dark matter, but having also a quartic cell interaction, but it can be supposed is repulsive. So in this case, for example, yeah, I think in one of my paper, I addressed this possibility. Let me see if I put in my back slides. I'm not sure. So yeah, here, yeah. Repulsive cell interaction. So the important thing is you can repeat the same analysis for axion dramatic clamps, having repulsive cell interaction, changing the sign, for example, of the quartic cell interaction. And then you will realize that there is only one branch of solution. There is not two, only one. And so you have, in the non-relativistic regime, you have a stable branch of solution. And the important thing here is there is not a maximum number of particles. So you can put more and more particles in the system and have but the radius of the configuration asymptotically approaches to a minimum radius. So, and why is important? It's important because, as I explained you before, if you have some defined axial photocopy constant, this is related to a critical number of particles. If the clamp has the critical number of particles, the clamps can undergo parametric resonance. However, in this case, there is no maximum number of particles in a clamp. So you can always have enough number of particles in the clamp in order to go and have parametric resonance. So for example, here, I am showing you, this is the grow rate, because this is the flock exponent. This is the grow rate, and this is the axial photocopy constant. So this for different number of particles, dimensionless number, this is 10, 20, 40. So even though you have a, in this case, very small axial photocopy constant, you have enough number, if you have a clamp with enough number of particles, you can have parametric resonance. Of course, there is a limit, because if you put too much particle, eventually the non-relativistic regime will break down. So I think thinking in your scenario, this scenario favor the possibility of emission of photons in the galaxy through collision and merger, but of course is less motivating.
Thank you.
Any other questions?
Hello. Yeah, thanks, Nico, for the nice talk. In your talk, you are focusing on spherically symmetric clumps in your study. So I was just wondering if you could have axion clumps with finite angular momentum. So could you make some comment on that?
I see. Right. So indeed, in the literature, you can find some papers about considering this finite angular momentum. This is called axion rotating or rotating jobs, for example. And right. So I have your back slide because also I did a research about that. So this, when you include angular momentum, so we are not talking about a true Bose-Einstein condensate, because this corresponds to higher angular state. But in any case, you can require that the a minimum state of energy of the system with fixed number of particles and also fixed angular momentum. So you can repeat the same procedure as before, just proposing this scrounging field, but you can add, for example, one spherical harmonic, and that's it. And then you try to minimize the energy, a fixed particle number, and also a fixed angular momentum. The answer now is different. Previously, in the case of spherical axiomatic clamps, you can use a Sesh answers, exponential answers, a linear exponential answer. Here is different because in the near region, this corresponds to the time-independent Schrödinger equation, but only in the near region. And you see that it's quite complicated because when R goes to zero, here is two term blows up. So then one answer which works is a modified Gaussian answer that found this some years ago. And if you use this modified Gaussian answer, you can capture the physics. So for example, this is the field with different angular momentum. As you see, this is for a zero angular momentum, and this is for finite angular momentum. So in the near region, is the situation changed drastically. So okay, the important thing here is the following. So when you include angular momentum, this corresponds to angular momentum zero, and this corresponds to angular momentum finite angular momentum. When you include angular momentum, you obtain, again, the same chain, two branches of solution in the non-relativistic regime. One branch is stable, and one branch is unstable. But the important thing here is, due to the angular momentum is finite, the maximum number of particles that you could put in a clamp is larger, and that is expected, okay? So, due to the maximum number of particles is larger, then that will enhance the probability of having parametric resonance. So indeed, for example, now the minimum axophotocoupling constant looks in this way. In the case for the spherical symmetric, it was 0.28 over FA. Now it's again 0.28 over FA, but over the square root of L. So in principle, if you have enough angular momentum, the QCD axion can undergo parametric arrestor. So regrettable, you need a very large angular momentum, so it's the order of 10 to the 3. But in any case, helps the situation. But we didn't make collision between this high angle state, and it would be very interesting to do that, because I am not sure if the system will tend to settle down to the ground state configuration or to a higher angle state. Because, for example, I can show you this non-head-on collision, because I didn't show that because the presentation was too long. So if you include some impact parameter, so here there's a torque, and then you have angular momentum here. So it's very complicated this way with this collision between two clamps. So they start to undergo an inspired motion here, but finally you end with a spherical configuration, and this configuration settle down to the ground state. So the system ejects particle, and these particles carry away the angular momentum, and you lose the angular momentum. So I am wondering if you collide two clamps with finite angular momentum, if the system will tend to clamps with angular momentum or just to the ground state. My guess is the system just will tend to the ground state. Okay.
Thank you very much.
Can I ask a question?
Okay.
I have a question.
Yeah. He's asking, Mr. Flamin, okay.
Just, Enrico, I know in your paper you had this discussion, but I didn't see it in the talk, which is, how is the merger rate affected by the relative phase between these two coherent objects? So there should be, they merge or don't merge there. So what is the effect on the merger rate because of that? I didn't see that in the talk, so if you could elaborate on that.
Right, yes, yes. Yes, because the paper is too long, so I couldn't say everything. So, right, this is the interference effect. When you have the initial wave function, you expect that both clamps hold uncorrelated phase. So what I show you is just the case when the phase is equal to zero. But what happens if you include a finite phase here? So zeta naught, so the separation of these two clamps is 2 zeta naught. So the time for maximum interaction, so in order to observe what is the interfering pattern, happen when zeta naught is equal to zero. So you get this interfering pattern. And you realize that there is for the case when the phase is equal to pi, there is a total destructive interference in the plane C equal to zero. And this correspond, the four rows correspond to the case of collision when the phase difference is equal to pi. Here, there is a void in the plane C equal to zero, and this void act as a repulsive force acting on the two clamps and prevent the collision of the clamps, and then the clamps just go away. So there is no merger. And this is the usual case for different phase equal to zero. But what happened if the different phase is not pi? So this is the case for pi over 2, and this is the case for 3 pi over 2. If you put here pi over 2, then the void happened in the plane equal to bc times c equal to pi over 4. So the plane is something here. So if the void plane can be interpreted as a repulsive force, then the clamps merge, but he starts to move to the left. And the opposite happens when you have the phase 3 pi over 2. This is very interesting, but physically it's not interesting at all, because there is merger in all cases apart from pi. With if you just consider a phase difference pi just plus and minus some small delta, you will have eventually a merger. So due to the phase difference equal to pi, just a very particular case. So physically, there is no effect on the merger process. The unique difference is the time for coalescence is a little longer. It's a little longer when the phase difference is going close to pi. But apart from that, there is no too much difference.
Okay, thank you very much. I suggest to postpone the questions if there are others.